So, friends,
Good morning.
just now we had a wonderful talk by Professor Billy Moriya, and we are eagerly waiting to listen to a talk by Professor Knut Axel Jacobsen. He is a professor in the Department of History of Religions at the University of Bergen in Norway. He has worked on different areas of classical Indian philosophy, with special reference to Sankhya and Yoga. A few months back, I had the opportunity of listening to one of his talks in Stockholm, and it was so great. You know, I just, not only me, I mean, everybody else who were there enjoyed his talk too much. And I think within a very short time, we became very good friends. So welcome, Professor
Yes.
Jacobsen, to our
Thank you.
online course on classical Indian philosophy. And without wasting any more time, over to you, Professor Jacobsen, now.
Fine. So thank you. And thank you for inviting me to give this lecture. Now I will share my screen. Let's see if I can
Yes.
make that happen. Let's see.
Ah, that's fine.
Yep.
Yeah.
And so my talk will be about a kapila in of Sankhya, and now it will be not a technical philosophical presentation, but I think it still will be of some interest to philosophers also, because Kapila is such an important figure. So my presentation explores the ancient figure of Kapila, who is celebrated as the founder of the Sankhya system of thought, and is a mythological figure involved in such mythological events as the coming to earth of the river Ganga, and who is associated as well with a number of sacred sites and even some institutions in India. In my presentations, I discuss some of the identities of Kapila in Sanskrit and other Indian sources. I look at how Indological research, as well as Indian intellectual traditions, have tried to make sense of Kapila and try to understand the plurality of interpretations, historical, mythological, and Indological. Since Kapila was, as we shall see, by some considered to be, and there are still many who think of him in this way, I believe, the founder of Indian philosophy, that is, as the first Indian philosopher, or even the first philosopher of mankind. The identity of Kapila and the history of the claims about him should interest philosophers also. Although my presentation probably is deconstructive rather than constructive, I hope it has some interest for philosophers. And I hope I will be able to destabilize some conceptions about Kapila. Now, Kapila figures are in the contemporary Hindu world not only associated with Sankhya system of Indian philosophy, of which he is famously celebrated as the founder, but he is also associated with a sacred geography, with temples of him being found at pilgrimage places, and he is worshipped or honored by several religious groups who consider him their main guru. Famous examples are the Mahanirvani Akara, that is the Akara that has the right to walk in front in the prestigious bathing processions in the Prayag Kumbh Mela, who consider Kapila their guru. An important pilgrimage place is the Ganga Sagar, just south of Kolkata, where Kapila is worshipped as a violent ascetic who killed 60,000 sons of Sagara because they disturbed his meditation, and it was for the purification of their souls that the river Ganga first descended from heaven to earth, according to the Ganga mythology. The teaching of Kapila, the son of Kardama and Devahuti, who taught Sankhya Yoga to his mother Devahuti, is told in the Bhagavata Purana, and is the foundation of several groups and a most important sacred site, Sidhpur in Gujarat. And of course, there are followers of the Sankhya Darshana tradition who consider Kapila their founder and original guru, the first knower. Let's move here. Now, the name Kapila refers to several mythologies and figures. Nonetheless, the most well-known Kapila in Indology and in philosophy is Kapila, the founder of the Sankhya system of philosophy, the Darshana called Sankhya. This Kapila is no minor figure in the Hindu tradition. Since Sankhya is considered the oldest of the Hindu philosophical systems, Kapila is considered the founder of philosophy. Unsurprisingly, therefore, several central religious figures in modern India have admired Kapila as a person of utmost importance for Indian philosophy and even for the world history of rational thought. The famous Vivekananda is one of them. He wrote that Kapila, whom he believed lived thousands of years ago, was the first philosopher in human history in which all other philosophy depended, because Kapila, Vivekananda argued, invented rational thought. Vivekananda wrote, "Kapila is the father of Indian thinkers. Buddhism and other systems are outcome of his thought." I give the whole... He argued, let's see, can you see the whole, or should I, like this, there is no philosophy in the world that is not indebted to Kapila. Pythagoras came to India and studied this philosophy, and that was the beginning of the philosophy of the Greeks. Later it formed the Alexandrian school, and still later the Gnostic. It became divided into two. One part went to Europe and Alexandria, and the other remained in India, and out of this the system of Vyasa developed. The Sankhya philosophy of Kapila was the first rational system that the world ever saw. Every metaphysician in the world must pay homage to him. I want to impress on your mind that we are bound to listen to him as the great father of philosophy, this wonderful man, the most ancient of philosophers. Now, of course, Vivekananda talked in big letters, but it's still quite interesting. Vivekananda thought that Kapila was the originator not only of Indian philosophy, but also Greek and European philosophy. He wrote, there is no philosophy in the world that is not indebted to Kapila. Yes. And now, wherever there is any philosophy or rational thought, it owes something or other to Kapila. Pythagoras learned it in India and taught it in Greece. Later on, Plato got an inkling of it, and still later, the Gnostics carried the thought to Alexandria, and from there it came to Europe. So whenever there is any attempt at psychology or philosophy, the great father of it is this man, Kapila. And he wrote, Kapila is the father of all Hindu psychology. And the ancient system that he taught is still the foundation of all accepted systems of philosophy in India today, which are known as the Darshanas. They all adopt his psychology, however widely they differ in other respects. I'll read one more quote from Vivekananda. Following the Upanishads, there came other philosophies of India, but every one of them failed in getting the hold on India, which the philosophy of Vyasa got. That is the Vyasa here, I think, is the yoga philosophy. Although the philosophy of Vyasa is a development out of an older one, the Sankhya. And every philosophy and every system in India, I mean throughout the world, owes much to Kapila, perhaps the greatest name in the history of India in psychological and philosophical lines. The influence of Kapila is everywhere, seen throughout the world. Wherever there is a recognized system of thought, there you can trace his influence, even if it be thousands of years back. Yet he stands there, the shining, glorious, wonderful Kapila. His psychology and a good deal of his philosophy have been accepted by all sects of India, but with very little differences. So, Vivekananda wrote with admiration about Kapila and some parts of Sankhya philosophy. He wrote that Vedanta is the logical outcome of the Sankhya. In his own philosophy, favoring union and monism and not dualism and separation, as the Sankhya philosophy teaches, and he supported the idea of God, which is not found in Sankhya or Sankhya yoga. And he also denied the plurality of Purushas and the independence of Prakriti. But on the question of the superiority of the philosopher, the Kapila philosophy, he was had no doubt. Now, I'll give a second example of modern ad admiration of Kapila, and this is the famous Bhimrao Ramji Ambedkar, the architect of the Indian constitution and leader of the Dalits and a convert to Buddhism. Now, in his most important work, The Buddha and His Dhamma, published in 1957 posthumously, and a book which is treated as scripture in Navayana Buddhism, he included a whole chapter on Kapila and wrote very favorable about him. He wrote, among the ancient philosophers of India, the most preeminent was Kapila. His philosophical approach was unique, and as philosopher, he stood in a class by himself. Now, this also illustrates the great appeal of the figure of Kapila in modern India. Many other examples can be found of persons claiming Kapila as the greatest thinker in India. I'll give just a couple of random examples. Now, Chinmay Ananda, a modern famous guru, claimed that their center in Sidbari was at a place the greatest thinker in India had his ashrama. So that's Kapila. And an Indian researcher, Pulgenda Sinha, in a 2000 publication, even claimed to have recovered the original Sankhya Karika, which he claimed was written by Kapila 700 before the Common Era. And that this recovery would impel the correction of all existing books in the history of Indian philosophy and would reshape the thinking pattern of the Indian people. Now, since Kapila is the first philosopher, then supposedly, the Sankhya Karika, without some of the verses, must then be the earliest text of philosophy, he argued. Now, against all evidence from Indological research, I should add. Now, this figure of Kapila, who Vivekananda argued was the originator not only of Indian, but also Greek and European philosophy, and who thus was the father, the great father of philosophy, and who Ambedkar thought was unparalleled among early Indian philosopher, then who was he? Is there any empirical evidence for there having been such a historical person? Or was Kapila a part of the mythological world like other divinities? No, very little information about Kapila is available in Sankhya texts. The Sankhya Karika by Ishvara Krishna, which is considered the foundation text of the so-called classical Sankhya system, composed between 350 and 450 perhaps of the Common Era, states that the teaching presented in the text was expounded by a great sage, Paramarshi, and that the teaching was given from this ascetic, Muni, to Asuri, and next from Asuri to Panchasika, who disseminated or expanded the teaching. The teaching was then transferred by disciples and finally condensed in the verses of the Sankhya Karika by Ishvara Krishnan. The name Kapila is never used in Sankhya Karika. The Sankhya Karika verses 69 and 70, which are the verses relevant for the analysis of Kapila, are these two verses. So here you see it. Purushartam idam guyam paramarshina samkhyatam shtiti utpatti pralayas chintayanta yatra bhutanam. And then etad pavitram agriam munir ashtoraye anukampaya trada dao Asurir api panchashikaya tena chabahuda kritam tantram. I can't chant it. I can only read it like this. So here, see, there is no mention of Kapila, but this Paramarshi and Muni mentioned in Sankhya Karika 69 and 70 is not given in the Sankhya Karika, but all the commentaries of the Sankhya Karika agree that this figure intended is Kapila. Yeah. Now, unlike famous ancient teachers such as Buddha, the Buddha and Mahavira, only one student of Kapila is known, or perhaps two, and that is Asuri, according to the Sankhya tradition. But according to the Vaishnava Sankhya tradition of the Bhagavata Purana, his mother, Devahuti, was his disciple. Or perhaps these were intended as two different Kapilas. The standard narrative of how Asuri became Kapila's student and the lineage of Sankhya was created is given in some commentaries of the Sankhya Karika, but it contains very few details about Kapila and is to be considered mythological. It does show, however, that according to this story, Sankhya is a philosophy of renunciation, of persons tired of a householder life. According to the Sankhya Karika commentary Suvarna Saptati and Sankhya Vritti on Karika 1, Kapila, overpowered by compassion for the suffering of all living beings, approached the Brahman Asuri, who had been making sacrifices for 1,000 years, and asked him if he fulfilled his duty as a householder with joy. Asvari answered, yes, and Kapila concluded that he was not ready and left him. He came back twice, and the last time Asvari answered no. He no longer fulfilled his duty as a householder with joy, and Kapila asked why, and Asvari answered that it was because of the threefold suffering. Which is the quotation then from Samkhya Karika 1 that the commentaries here are contextualizing. Asvari then left his family and started the life of a renunciate, becoming the student of Kapila. So already the Mahabharata refers to the view that Kapila was the promoter of Sankhya. And the term Kapilaha, followers of the teaching of Kapila, is found in the Mahabharata, and it means followers of the philosophy of Sankhya. Several commentaries on the Sankhya Karika, that is Yuktidipika, Mataravritta Gaudapada Bhasha, Jayamangala, Tattva Kaumudi, claim that at the very beginning of manifestation, world manifestation, was equipped with four perfections of knowledge, virtue, non-attachment, and power. Now, these are the four of the eight so-called bhavas, constituents of the buddhi, or tendency in the buddhi. And according to, and he had then perfected the four good ones. And according to Jayamangala, Kapila was endowed with this naturally. They were not due to any effort on his part. Yuktidipika says that at the beginning of each cycle of creation, Prakriti, having brought forth the 23 manifest tattvas, then generated the body of Kapila as the first being who emerged in manifest existence. So these are, what you call it? Creative mythological speculations. The text explains that Kapila was born naturally endowed with a means of liberation because of the predominance of sattva, the sattva guna in him. Yuktidipika elaborates that the bodies of divinities are of four kinds, the first of which is that of Brahma, here called Virinsha, and Kapila, called Paramarshi, that appeared directly from the material principles. The Sankhya Kapila is referred to here as the Adi Vidvan, the first knower. Is referred to as the Adi Vidvan, the first knower in the Patanjali Yoga Shastra, the text of the Sankhya Yoga School. And according to Patanjali Yoga Shastra, Kapila appears at the beginning of each cycle of creation, endowed with the four perfections, that is the four bhavas, the four good bhavas, out of compassion gives knowledge to Asuri by taking recourse to a nirmana chitta. Buddhist influence is visible here. The Kapila is not the historical figure here, but a divinity surrounded by mythology. In the Bhagavata Purana is found a teacher of Vaishnava Sankhya named Kapila, who is born from a mother called Devahuti, and the father is Kardama. The Sankhya Karika commentary Mataravritti follows this line of interpretation, and it's a late commentary, and by then Kapila was considered a teacher of Vaishnava Sankhya, a god considered an avatara of Vishnu, which had then become promoted by the Bhagavata Purana and was then accepted also in the Tattva Kaumudi commentary of Vachaspati Mishra. Now, it is a remarkable fact that no ancient archaeological material has been identified with any Sankhya institution, as far as I know, in contrast to the rich material from the Buddhist and Jain institutions. In fact, no ancient statues of Kapila has been found, which contrasts significantly with the enormous number of statues of the Buddha and Mahavira and other Buddhist and Jain teachers. Different reasons for this can be given, but it seems to show absence of significant monastic Samkhya institutions and adds to the mystery of the identity of a possible philosopher named Kapila. Now, I will say something about Kapila in Indological scholarship. In spite of the many statements of admiration of Kapila by Vivekananda and Ambedkar and others that I have cited or referred to, the best Indological scholarship on Sankhya are mostly in agreement that there is no evidence to support a view that there ever was a historical person named Kapila, who was a philosopher and founder of the Sankhya system. The so-called first Indian philosopher seems then never to have existed. Johannes Brønckhorst has stated that we should abandon the idea, quote, abandon the idea that Kapila ever was an ordinary human being, end of quote. Albert Wessler, an excellent Indologist, suggested in an article in 1969-1970 that Kapila was the god Ishvara of Sankhya. For Brønckhorst, Kapila was a god of the greater Magadha that he has promoted, and according to him, the only name of a Magadha god that has survived. Kapila, then, who in the Hindu tradition is considered the founder of the Sankhya system, and by some the beginning of rational thought as such, according to Vivekananda, seems, according to Indology, most likely to have a mythological origin or be a purely mythological figure. The association of Samkhya with a mythological Kapila figure might probably have been for the sake of providing Samkhya with a proper lineage, has been suggested by Gerald Larson. That is, in other words, the association is a fiction. Now, any arguments for Kapila being a historical figure need to make sense of a number of narratives that are clearly not about a human figure, but about a mythological being with divine powers, that is, a divinity and a product of the religious imagination. The most well-known narrative involving a sage called Kapila is found in a Ramayana and a Mahabharata, is the story of the coming to earth of the river Ganga that I mentioned. Kapila was here an ascetic, seated in the netherworld, where the 60,000 sons of King Sagara discovered him when they were digging a gigantic hole in the earth, a hole which now is filled with the water and constitutes the ocean Sagara. And they were searching for their father's lost sacrificial horse. Next to Kapila, they found the horse bound to a tree, which this was an act of the god Indra. The sons of King Sagara accused Kapila of having stolen the horse, and Kapila burned them to ashes in anger when they in this way disturbed his peace. The myth intends to explain the salvific power of River Ganga, and it's also an etymological story that aims to provide entertainment to an audience, telling a narrative that explains why the Sanskrit word for ocean is Sagara. Kapila's role in this narrative is obviously not as a historical person. The association of Kapila with Sankhya is stated already in the Mahabharata, and Kapila is also mentioned in the Bhagavad Gita chapters of the Mahabharata, where the Muni, Kapila, is named as the foremost of the Siddhas. Siddhanam Kapila Munihi. And this might very well be intended to be a reference to the mythological Kapila. But in the Hindu epics and the Puranas are mentioned several different Kapila figures. Mani, this encyclopedia of Puranas lists eight different figures with the name Kapila in this text that he had access to. And interestingly, in a dictionary of the of Pali proper names, as many as 12 different Kapilas are listed in the Pali texts of the Buddhists. Only very few of these Pali references to Kapila are from the oldest text, and no god or divine mythological figure called Kapila is mentioned in the Pali texts. The texts refer to several Buddhist monks named Kapila, and two Brahman priests and one physician, but these can neither be identified with the philosopher Kapila nor with the mythological Kapila. Kapila, the Sankhya philosopher, is mentioned in one text, Dhammapala's Udanatta Katha, but he is just mentioned together with Kanada as having taught that the soul was limitless. This is a text from probably the 6th century of the Common Era. Most notable in the Pali Buddhist text is the absence of a mythological divine figure of Kapila, which makes a Shramana or a Magadhi origin of the mythological Kapila, as was claimed by Bronkhorst, very highly unlikely. The most famous of the Kapilas mentioned in a Pali Buddhist textual tradition is a Brahman named Kapila, who is stated to be a previous rebirth of the Buddha, and who was a family priest of Upachara, the king of Chetia, who in the story lies and goes to hell, and is explained as a rebirth of Devadatta. The two teachers of the Buddha, Alara Kalama and Uddakaramaputra, are identified in the Pali canon by name. The source of the account is probably this Ariya Pariyasena Sutta of the Majjhima Nikaya. The teaching of the Shramana teachers has been associated with Samkhya, but there is no mention of any Kapila in the Majjhima Nikaya text. An interpretation that Kapila Vastu was named after a Sankhya philosopher Kapila is without any textual evidence. So most notable in the Pali text is the absence of a mythological sage named Kapila. Let's see. While most commonly in the commentaries of Sankhya Karika is the claim that at the very beginning of manifestation, Kapila was equipped with the four perfections, knowledge, virtue, non-attachment, and power, some commentaries give additional interpretations. One gets the impression that later commentaries sought to bring in new details on the nature and origin of Kapila as part of their interpretive contribution and consolidation efforts. Gaudapada in Sankhya Karika identifies Kapila as one of the seven great seers who are the mind-born sons of Brahma, an identity already mentioned in the Mahabharata. A late commentary, the Mataravritti, shows influence from Puranic developments in its interpretations. I mentioned this is the idea that Kapila was the son of Prajapati Kardama and Manu Swayam Bhu's daughter Devahuti. This is promoted in the Bhagavata Purana. This Kapila is a divinity identified as an avatar of Vishnu. And as an avatar of Vishesha, a particular incarnation of Vishnu, according to Vachaspati Mishra. So, now, while Indologists who have studied the matter have argued that there is no evidence of a historical Kapila, and he should better be understood as a divinity and a mythological figure, some Hindus have, on the contrary, argued that to make sense of the reference to Kapila, there had to be two Kapilas. The famous Shankara, or Adi Shankaracharya, distinguished between two Kapilas because of their doctrine of the independence of Prakriti and plurality of Purushas. He was left with a problem that Kapila is mentioned in the Shvetashvatara Upanishad, that is 5.2, which is a Shruti text, which would mean that Sankhya was supported by the Veda. Shankara solved it by arguing in Brahma Sutra Bhasha 2.1.1 that there were two Kapilas, the Sankhya Kapila and a different one, the Kapila who killed the sons of Sagara, and argued that the Svetashvatara Upanishad, Shruti, referred only to the second Kapila. A contemporary Sankhya scholar, Ramchankar Bhattacharya, who passed away in 1996, believed Kapila was a historical person. He also argued that there were two Kapilas, and that the violent Kapila of the Ganga Sagar was different from the Sankhya Kapila. He has shown that many of the epithets used for the Sankhya Kapila are never used for the violent Kapila. But Acharya argues that their identity is only claimed in two texts, the Bhagavata Purana and the Devi Bhagavata Purana. No, the Bhagavata Purana solves this by arguing that Kapila's violence at Ganga Sagar was in reality an illusion. The violence did not really take place. But this does not solve the problem of two Kapilas, because the teaching of Kapila in the Kapila Upadesha of the Bhagavata Purana is quite different from the teaching of Kapila in that is taught in the Sankhya Karika. Now, Bhaktivedanta Prabhupada, the famous founder of ISKCON, used the idea of two Kapilas to solve this problem and argued that there were, in reality, two Kapilas. One Kapila was the son of Kardama and Devahuti, and an avatara of Krishna, who taught Sankhya Yoga to his mother in the Bhagavata Purana. And the second one was a later imposter, the Kapila of Sankhya Darshana tradition. Bhaktivedanta Prabhupada wrote, "We must distinguish between the two Kapilas. One Kapila is the Bhagavan Kapila, and the other Kapila is the atheist Kapila. Bhagavan Kapila is also known as Devahuti Putra Kapila. Both Kapilas expounded Sankhya philosophy, but the atheist expounded it without understanding, perception, or realization of God," Prabhupada wrote. Now, Sankhya commentaries usually do not consider the idea of many Kapilas. The commentaries of Sankhya Karika give very short presentations of Kapila. The main point of these presentations is that Kapila gave his teaching to Asuri, who was no longer interested in life as a householder. The presentation makes mostly only two points, that the Parampara was established and that Sankhya is meant for sannyasins. Now Kapila has a significant presence in the Puranas and in Hindu sacred geography. Here often different Kapila identities merge and are unified. He is associated with a number of traditions of pilgrimage and worship in contemporary India. The largest pilgrimage festival in West Bengal is connected to Kapila at Sagar Island, celebrating his role in the coming to earth of the river Ganga. Another significant pilgrimage site is the Kapilashram in Sidhpur, which is connected to the narrative in the Bhagavata Purana of the child god Kapila, who gave the teaching of moksha to his mother, Devahuti. This is the Tirtha for performing Gaya Shraddha for dead mothers. Now, the mythological figure of Sankhya Kapila has sometimes been enriched and interwoven with additional narratives, several of which are connected to sacred sites. A historical process seems to have taken place in which some places associated with a name, Kapila and Kapila, feminine, have added the idea of the Sankhya Kapila to their sacred identity. This is perhaps easiest to document in a case of places associated with a yaksha called Kapila, who was known in ancient India. Several place names in India are derived from this yaksha. Filippi and Marciolongo, in a book from 1999 on Campiglia, it's south of Delhi. They have argued then that this Campiglia is named after the Yaksha Kapila. But the recent Sanskrit text, Campiglia Mahatmya, written in the 20th century, connects the place to the sage Kapila, which probably had no connection to the place previously. Kapila was also a name of one of the five yakshas that guarded Kurukshetra. An ancient temple at the place Kalayat, the name is probably also from Kapilayat, and named after the yaksha Kapila. It's in Haryana. But the ancient temple there is today dedicated to the Sankhya sage. But this association with Sankhya Kapila of the site was perhaps because of the Yaksha Kapila, and then the association to the Sankhya sage Kapila came later. Sites have also become connected to Sankhya Kapila because of a similarity of his name with the Kapila cow and the Kapila river. These are both feminines. The word Kapila is a color word meaning red or red-brown. The name of the childhood town of the Buddha, Kapila Vastu, perhaps meant just red-brown place. But later, authors connected it sometimes to the mythological Sankhya Kapila. In one case from the Skanda Purana, there is the merging of the sage Kapila, the Kapila cow, and the Kapila river. And the case is quite instructive of how this process has worked historically. In the Skanda Purana, Book 5, Avantya Kanda, Section 3, Reva Kanda, is told the story of the origin of River Kapila and the greatness of Kapila Tirtha. According to the text, on the northern bank of Narmada, there is the river Kapila, and along its banks, more than 100 crore sages have been performing penance and attained liberation from rebirth. And this river Tirtha was named after Kapila. The text says, since the noble-souled Kapila performed penance there, a meritorious Tirtha has sprung up there. It was resorted to formerly by sages following Kapila. It has been praised by the name Kapila. It is destructive of all sins. However, a few verses further down, the text gives another explanation of the name. The goddess Gauri, that is Parvati, played in the water with Shiva, and rising from water, she changed clothes, and her attendants squeezed her wet clothes. Drops of color resembling a rainbow fell down and created the river Kapila. And due to the Kapila color, that is the red-brown color, the river became Kapila by name, the text says. There are many more examples. The text tells of Kapila himself traveling to a Kapila Tirtha to get rid of moral impurity. After having caused the violent death of the 60,000 sons of Sagara, Kapila was extremely distressed, we learn from this Revakanda. And Kapila thought, when the mind has been freed from all sensuous objects, and when every contact has been eschewed, it's improper on my part to have destroyed 60,000 men. But the thing done cannot be undone. I shall therefore go to the Kapila Tirtha, that is destructive of all sins, and get rid of my sins. Kapila then left and settled at Kapila Tirtha on the banks of Narmada. Even the very famous Kapila Radha pilgrimage site in Varanasi, which is the part of the Panchakroshi pilgrimage, the resting place of the fifth day, seems to have been named after the Kapila cow and got connected to Kapila the sage only later. In the narrative in the Skanda Purana about its creation, the sage Kapila is not mentioned at all, only the Kapila cow, from whom Kapila Radha received its name. The Kapila statue at Kapila Radha is from around 1810. And the connection of the place to the sage Kapila is perhaps not that much older. So, what to make of all this? Now, there is no evidence to support that Kapila, who is claimed to be the founder of Samkhya, was a historical person. This perhaps distinguishes Kapila from the founders of other Hindu philosophical systems, who seem to have been historical person and the actual composers of the foundational sutra text of the systems, such as Padarayana, Brahma Sutra, Jaimini of Mimamsa Sutra, Gautama of Nyaya Sutra, Kanada of Vaisheshika Sutra, and Patanjali of the Yoga Sutra. Although hardly anything is known about these figures, that is historical knowledge. Two available Sankhya texts are claimed to have been authored by Kapila, that is the Sankhya Sutra and the Tattva Samasa Sutra, which both are from the 14th and 15th century. And they may very well have been authored by a person or two persons called Kapila, who lived at that time, that is in the 14th and 15th century, or they have been purposely or wrongly attempted ascribed to the mythological Kapila. Now, to make sense of Kapila, different solutions then have been suggested. Two Kapilas, we saw Shankaracharya, Bhaktivedanta Prabhupada, and others. One Kapila, or zero Kapilas. The proposal of two Kapilas is going back to at least Shankara in the 8th century and has appeared again later, and dividing up also differently. Indologist has mainly concluded that Kapila is a mythological figure with no historical evidence of a person named Kapila as founder of Sankhya. So here there is no Kapila. And the claim by Bronkhorst that Kapila is the name of the only surviving name of a god of the Magadha civilization is highly unlikely, since there is no mention of such a god in the Pali canon, or nor is there mention of such a god in the Jain texts. Some Sankhya commentaries seems to have placed Kapila at the beginning of creation together with Brahma, and the Bhagavata Purana makes him an avatar of Vishnu. So here he is a kind of a divine figure, and then a part of mythology. But contemporary Hindu tradition often promote Kapila as a historical figure, and a very, sometimes very important one, as we saw with Vivekananda and Ambedkar also. And at Hindu pilgrimage places to Kapila, which there are quite a number, he seems to have been blended into one single mythological figure. So according to some modern historical Hindu views, Kapila was the originator not only of Indian philosophy, but also Greek and European philosophy, the great father of philosophy, a wonderful man, the most ancient of philosophers, as Vivekananda wrote. On the other hand, Indological research have argued that taking Kapila as a historical figure or a historical person makes it impossible to make sense of him based on textual sources. So, of course, in Indic traditions, the boundary between what is human and what is divine is indeed much more porous than in Western traditions, of which Indology often is part. I'll conclude with one thought. The Indologist Gerald Larson argued that on the issue of history and myth, there is a reversal between the views of the Indic traditions, which Hinduism is considered a part of, and modern scholars. Larson suggested that what Indic traditions would consider to be history, let's see, modern scholars appear to construe as myth. That is, what Indic tradition consider to be history, modern scholars appear to construe as myth, and what modern scholars appear to construe as history is what Indic traditions themselves would for the most part consider to be myth. Now, the figure of Kapila seems to be good examples of this reversal of myth and history between scholars and Hindu traditions. Vivekananda Ambedkar, that I used as examples here, promoted, certainly argued that Kapila was a historical figure, but Indologists claim that he is better understood as a myth, and that the historical figure must be given up. And even Indologists argue that thinking of Kapila as a historical person makes it impossible to make sense of him. And then in Western scholarship, to make sense of him, you have to argue that this is a mythological figure, and then you make sense of him within that kind of analysis. And let me just show some examples of. Of what's the drawings or prints or statues of how he is conceived. Here is this Mahanirvanakara. This is a modern poster. It's often placed in temples that is controlled by the Mahanirvanakara. Here is the horse in the background and the god Indra placing it. So this is a kind of a warrior ascetic. But the Mahanirvanakara also thinks of him as the founder of the Sankhya philosophy and argue that. Here is the statue of him, Mahanirvanakara. They worship him as their guru, so Dakara has no living gurus. And here is Ganga Sagar. I'm sure some of you have been there. This is from Sidhpur, so that is the child Kapila teaching Devahuti and talking here with Kardama and Devahuti. I think the teaching was only to Devahuti. So this is from a Sidhpur Mahatmya text from the printed in the 20th century. And here is an order of that monastic order that followed the Bhagavata Purana. And so this is also Kapila that is worshipped. The guru is a female because Kapila taught Devahuti. So that gives the model of the female teacher of Sankhya. This is from Gaya, the Kapila Dara, that is an old place, probably associated originally with maybe a river or a small river called Kapila, and then now associated with Kapila. And this is also a statue of Kapila of some contemporary followers of Kapila of the Sankhya Darshana. Yes, so so this is what I my presentation, and it has challenged the view of one of the figures who is the early figures of Indian philosophy. I mean, the philosophers that then become known and formulate, those who formulate Samkhya philosophy are known as Varshaganya, Vindhyavasi, Nishvara Krishna, and so on. But still, he is considered kind of a figure in Indian philosophy. And then, but there are, for Indologists to seek historical evidence, they end up with kind of an empty hand. There is no historical figure, and then they have to make him into a mythological figure, and then with I am curious, of course, what you think of Kapila. I mean, is your perceived or inherited notion here is that he is an important figure, or I mean, there is there is some, he is mentioned in so many sources that means I think some would check the Pali text. I mean, it seems so obvious that Kapilavastu, that the later myth about that is that Buddha convinced Kapila to leave the place, so it was, but then it had to be named after him as a kind of honoring him. But it's a very late story. It has not found anywhere in the Pali canon. So when you look at the historical sources, all these things disappear. I have visited and written about many of these places associated with Kapila, but there is really no historical evidence, and the but typically all narratives of him are kind of added on, and typically then he's also always associated with the Sankhya teaching. So even in Ganga Sagar, he will be promoted as a Sankhya philosopher. And sometimes at these places, it's hard to know when you go at least many hundred years back in time, then there are no historical records. So it's you can use kind of place name etymologies, but then you have the other words, the Kapila cow and the Kapila river. So at least one conclusion is one should be careful about identifying Samkhya ideas with Kapila. He's called kind of founder of Samkhya, yes, but in what sense is he a founder? I mean, the kind of identification that Vivekananda attempted, I don't think that is, I mean, that was part of the political context also, I think, that Vivekananda functioned in. But his admiration for Kapila and of course, the idea that Indian philosophy was earlier than Greek philosophy, then that's, I say, still an open discussion. But to believe that Kapila was the originator of modern of philosophy and psychology, etc., that is seems to be part of a paying homage to really a mythological Kapila more than an actual historical person. But of course, then we have this the question of reversals of mythology and history that Larson claims is at work here. So.
Okay. Thank you very much, Professor Jacobson, for presenting the questions concerning the identity of Kapila as the founder of Sankhya philosophy. It's really interesting to know that a man who was regarded as sort of originator of all philosophical ideas, et cetera, by Vivekananda and others, we know almost nothing about his life, about his activities, et cetera. So, but one thing I was curious to know, Professor Jacobson, when Shankaracharya in his Bhashya was refuting some of the Sankhya doctrines, was he arguing that actually these doctrines are not advocated by the real, Kapila, but some pseudo Kapila, something like that?
As far as I remember, he doesn't mention yes, your question is if actually ascribing any of the Sankhya points of view to
Right.
Kapila. Of course, he's not quoting. The Sankhya was very well known as the kind of the Sankhyans were followers of Kapila. But there is no quotations of Kapila, and it has. I think the as part of his argumentation, the question come up, but Kapila is mentioned in Shruti, so how is it that his teachings are wrong? So then he solves that by arguing that, because you can argue that, okay, that Sankhya argue that Prakriti is an independent principle, which Sankhya would deny very much. And Sankhya argue that the Purushas are many, which Shankara would deny very strongly. And then an opponent could say, yes, but Kapila, who is the founder of this school, he is mentioned in Shruti, in Shvetasvatara Upanishad. So therefore, you should con it can't be, you are wrong, you could say. And then his answer would be, yes, but there is another Kapila, the Kapila of the story of the coming to earth of Ganga, the Kapila of Ganga Sagar, and clearly Shruti mentioned him. I don't think if you read the Svetasvatara Upanishad that that's the first thing that comes to mind, that this is a Puranic story about. But there are other argument that neither of these two are meant by the Svetasvatara Upanishad. It is, I mean, it's open who is referred to, but for so it was part of how, because Shankara in Brahmasutra Bhasha, for him the main opponent was Sankhya. So if he said if that's the strongest opponent, so if he, the strongest philosophy, so if he can defeat Sankhya, he said he had in reality defeated every other philosophy. Therefore, he had to consider many of the points of view, and Copley certainly had that strong role. The Sankhya had claimed Kapila as the founder of their philosophical lineage, So, and that seems to have been accepted. So Shankara could not kind of deny that, but he just then denied, I said that there were two Kapilas instead. That's one way of solving it. And it's interesting that Prabhupada uses the kind of the same way of arguing more than 1,000 years later to solve a similar problem. That how is it that the Sankhya of the Bhagavata Purana is different from the Kapila Sankhya? And then he saw that these are really two different persons. And then Indologist claiming that there is no Sankhya at all. So, which is, I don't think it's a kind of an unusual situation when we talk about, let's see, about even ancient Greek philosophers. I don't think there are anyone that you have similar type of arguments. Of course, you have had the idea of Patanjali, that there have been claimed that because that there are a Patanjali the grammarian, a Patanjali the Ayurvedic teacher, and then Patanjali of the Yoga Sutra. So there you have a similar, and of course, no historical evidence at all about the yoga teacher Patanjali, except that there is this idea that that was the name of the person who composed the Yoga Sutra. It's not an unusual situation. I think Badarayana, there is nothing known. There is also there an interesting mythology that came up later, but not now. While Vijaymini, Asko Parpola has done a lot of work on identifying Jaimini, and there are some sources in the Brill's Encyclopedia of Hinduism was published now with a volume 7, and in that article that issue there are article of some founders that is on Patanjali, on Jaimini, and on Kapila. Then so I have written on Kapila. So Jaimini, there are actually some historical evidence, while Badarayana, nothing. And Patanjali, I think the what's there is that there is a, because of the very popularity of yoga in the late 19th and then especially 20th, 21st centuries, there are kind of Patanjali statues coming up in India, and it's becoming quite a popular figure, but it's a kind of a new thing. I don't think there were any there, yeah, there is maybe some a statue maybe in Chidambaram of a, but that's a mythological story than to explain the name of Patanjali. And then of course when you come to the philosophers that like in Sankhya also Varsha Gandhi and Vindhyavasin, there are quotations that have survived in the commentary literature, but very hardly any biographical information at all. So that but when we get to the commentaries of Sankara, at least we got get longer texts, but it is yeah, it is sometimes claimed that you know Indian philosophy is associated with systems and not persons, but actually the persons are always named, but often there is very little information about them. So Sankhya is associated with a very large number of names, but often without much information about them.
I guess some of our participants have some questions to ask. So yes, please go ahead.
Yeah, am I audible to you?
Yes, please go
Yes.
ahead.
Yeah. So, first of all, thank you, Professor Jacobson, to present your very good and nice presentation. And being a scholar of Sankhya, so I just have two questions, not rigidly from the point from your presentation, but related to your presentation. But I think you'll be the plausible one to answer my questions. So first is, who do you think getting entangled in bondage and liberation in Sankhya philosophy? This is the first question. And because why I'm telling this, in Sankhya Karika, I think there are apparent contradictions in some Karikas, like 62 Karikas of Sankhya Karika, which is telling that Tasman na baddhate adhyaya na muchyate na pi samsarati kaschit samsarati baddhate muchyate cha nanasraya prakriti. So it is telling that it's prakriti who is getting an entangled bondage and also liberated. But on the other hand, in Karika number 55, it's telling that tatra jarmana kitam dukkham prapnoti chetanaha purusaha. It means that it is just purusha is getting entangled in bondage and also liberated. In another karika, which is 21, it is telling that actually the bondage and liberation is not purusha or prakriti, but this two, association of two, both are getting in both are in bondage and also liberated. So that's why I'm just asking this question, because this sometimes, and not sometimes but all the times, it you know, asks me always. So yeah, who is in bondage and who gets liberated? So this is the first question. And the second question is,
কম্পিটিটিভলি এক্সাম দিয়ে দিতে হ্যাঁ মেইন যেটা
হ্যালো
Yes.
So, yeah. So the second question is, many scholars they say that Sankhya is actually atheist, which I don't think. And from the perspective of Hariharananda, I know that you are a good scholar of Hariharananda, because I read a couple of books of written by you on Hariharananda, the yoga in modern Hinduism, and so on. So what do you think, that Sankhya, is Sankhya really atheist, or if it is, then why? Are if it is not, then what is the reason behind it? Thank you.
Thank you. No, these are very good questions. So on the first one, now, yeah, I think it's difficult to write the tech. I mean, to figure it, to write exactly on it, but for the Sankhya teaching to work, purusha is totally passive principle, so it can't do anything. So therefore, they have to solve that by assigning a function in prakriti, that is in buddhi, to attain that. But the bondage is not ontological, it's only epistemological. So therefore, once the buddhi in a way realizes that viveka, that truth, then in a way it realizes something that is already there. So So all activity has to be take place in buddhi, bondage is only an illusion since it's epistemological and not ontological. But your question is if Isvara Krishna has managed to present his teaching without contradictions, that some verses can be interpreted to mean something else than what I just presented. And that is possible, but it's also possible that it has to do with different stages in the process and different views. But that's at least that how I understand it, that the Purusha is contentless consciousness, the passive witness, and unchangeable, so that everything, all change is going on in Prakriti, but that change doesn't really make any difference for Purusha, because Purusha is always, in a way, a witness. So, in Sankhya, the Buddha is really kind of a major player. No Amkara from Amkara flows the other tattvas, but Buddha has the 8 bhavas and the 50 pratyayas. So, kind of very much of the world that we experience is really something that is in Buddha. And so that's at least. In a way, I will study closely the Sankhya Karika verses that you mentioned. Now, the other question of Sankhya as a living philosophy, and of course, this Kapil Matahari Harananda Aranya, that is Sankhya Yoga, but very much also Samkhya, of course, but he was kind of able to make Samkhya Yoga into a kind of monastic practice, yes, it raises the question, I think, and it's also I touched on in earlier in my lecture that there is no archaeological remains of any Sankhya, while there are these enormous number of archaeological remains of Buddhism and Jainism, for instance. So my thinking is that Sankhya was maybe always as a monastic or as kind of quite small, and that it has been maybe revived several times, that there was a revival in the 14th, 15th, 16th century when we had this Tattva Samasa Sutra and Sankhya Sutra. But after that also, and that we find maybe Sankhya philosophy as more strongly in other philosophies who kind of worked on it and change some of it, so that there is, I mean, the Yoga Sutra and which is a Sankhya, text is a kind of a world famous text translated. I think now the most translated text after the Bhagavad Gita, but very many of these people who read that text don't really understand that it's Sankhya philosophy that is behind it. No Hari Harananda Aranya, he did attract followers, and his the Guru Dharma Mega Aranya also did, but it is a kind of a very small institution and never attracted very many people, and which would have disturbed the peace of the institution. So I think they are quite happy with it. But But I don't think Sankhya has kind of outplayed its role. I think it's still a very important philosophy, and especially now as part of the as Sankhya yoga, as part of the and I think now I mean yoga has such global popularity, and also the Yoga Sutra. So at some point, people will get interested in the philosophy of the at least the Patanjala Yoga Shastra, and then they will encounter and be more and more interested in Sankhya. There is also a global interest in Bhagavad Gita, which is very much a Sankhya text, although it's not a Sankhya philosophy text.
Any other
So,
question or clarification from other participants?
can I ask just a follow-up question, sir?
First, let us see whether other people are interested. Let them give a chance. Anybody else? Okay, then Biplav, go ahead.
So the thing is actually why I am asking about God in Sankhya philosophy. Is Sankhya philosophy atheist or not? Because I do think that Hariharananda actually accepts God in in certain some but actually the problem is I'm not getting any core kind of something by which by or on based on this I'll argue that I can argue that Sankhya it is according to Hariharananda Sankhya is accepting God. But I've got many places in Hariharananda's book. I think you may know that Patanjala Yoga Darsana, written by Hariharananda Aranya. So many places, I think that actually Hariharananda accepts God. So that's my point. And let's just ask me one little question that do you know or do you think that in Sankhya and the yoga the author of the founder of Sankhya philosophy and the founder of Patanjali Yoga Darsana are actually different. What I am trying to say is, the first founder is Kapila, and the second founder is Patanjali. Or you think that it is Kapila who actually found these two, darshanas?
So then, as a kind of historian and Indologist, I have to say that that's I don't there is no kind of evidence of any historical copula, but I do think that the Patanjali Yoga Shastra, that is the yoga philosophy, is a school of Sankhya, and that person was very much a Sankhya person. But he introduced then a meditation philosophy and merged Sankhya with a meditation philosophy. So the method the method to be practiced according in the Patanjala Yoga is quite different from the practice of Adyavasaya of the Sankhya philosophy of the Sankhya Karika, though. So on the question of God is also very interesting, but then I think to discuss that you first have to define God very clearly, because there are many types of gods, and some are very minor, and then you have the kind of the monotheistic type, and then how do people relate of God? What do they expect from these figures, etc. So, but I think that in a in the Patanjali Yoga Shastra, the idea of Ishvara here is a very kind of not a god with a capital G. It's a person who is a quite minor figure, but he can help in the practice. But Hararananda Aranya, he was definitely not a theist, I think, but he did. There is the idea that Ishvara is a particular kind of Purusha that kind of helps in meditation, that is a kind of a model, because to in a way, the Purusha can never be an object of meditation. That makes it a little bit difficult. But then by having the Ishvara, making that as an object of meditation, you can kind of, that can help you in the meditation on Purusha, you could say, since you can't make Purusha itself an object of meditation, because it's always the subject. So it's a kind of a help. And if you go at least to the Patanjali Yoga Shastra itself, I think the Ishvara plays a very minor role, and it should never be translated with God as a capital G. And I think many modern kind of yoga movements have this wrongly, too much influenced, I think, by Vedanta and the idea of a great God, Brahman, and so on. But this is very interesting and
yeah, he doesn't accept creator God. That's
no.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess.
Okay, thank you, sir.
So thank you.
Yeah,
thank you.
So with that note, let us end this lecture session here. And again, I convey my sincere thanks to Professor Jacobson for being with us, for sharing his understanding about the historicity of Kapila, the alleged founder of Sankhya philosophy. And I hope, even in future, we will have Professor Jacobson's lecture on other occasions also. So Professor Jacobson, thank you very much.
So thank you for having me. Thank you for listening, and very great to see you again.
Yes. Thank you. All the best.